Hello everybody and welcome to Forever Rugby on Forever Sports. For today's video, we're going to be doing a look back, a reflection of the South Africa versus Wales game and look at four winners and four losers basically from the game itself. Basically looking at some really positive aspects of the match and people or aspects which were really good and lots to celebrate. And then things which were maybe a bit of red flags, things to maybe worry about or look back at, be a bit frustrated about. And it's always a nice sort of thing to sort of look at it at a match and sort of see where do we take steps forwards, where do we take steps backwards, for example, who took steps forward, who took steps backward. And the big thing I want to know from you guys is what do you think? Let me know down in the comments below. Please do smash a like on the video, subscribe to the channel as well, because in the world of arguments, debates, and the likes, we can have a conversation. So I want to know what your opinions are in the comments down below. Basically, what we're going to be doing, as I said, four winners, four losers. We're going to be going a winner, then a loser in each sort of category. And that's where sort of basically just my take. So let's get into it. Okay, we're going to start with a winner, which is going to be the man on everybody's lips, Sacha Fame Ingoma Zulu. What a game he had. And rightly so, everyone's absolutely raving about the next big number 10 in the world, the next big talent coming out of the South African rugby factory. To announce yourself with a 55-meter penalty off the tee is a pretty good way of saying I am the real deal. And we got a really cool interview with him last night that Dan Scholtz, who was at the game for us. And if you haven't seen it, go check out the on the channel there, because spoke about the fact that he just wasn't flustered, he wasn't nervous, his heart rate wasn't high, and that he was very, very comfortable. And that sort of shows you, first of all, the type of attitude, but also maybe the pedigree he has. Looked very tidy when he came on, made about five tackles, I think he did, which is where I think him playing at inside centres has really helped him for the Stormers. Didn't have too much to do with regards to sort of distribution, go forward ball. We were kind of just sort of seeing the game off really by, when he came on. But had some very nice touches, kicked for touch very nicely, kicked for goal very nicely, and just looked very comfortable. I think that's probably the best way of looking at it. He looked comfortable. So exciting things to come from him. I really like to see him play a bit more at 10 for the Stormers, for example, as you start to nurture, a very exciting talent. But I also think that working with Tony Brown is going to be absolutely amazing. Even credit to Tony Brown, as well as kicking coach at the Stormers for sort of the work that's been done. In terms of the first losers, we'll state the obvious, shall we? That was Wales. Now, obviously, they lost the match quite literally. But I think the main thing for Wales is winning is a habit, as is losing. And that is now, I mean, Wooden Spoon, winners of the World Cup, another loss to their name. And unfortunately, for a lot of these players, very young group of players, they don't know what it's like to win test matches. They're not used to winning test matches. And that is a culture that's going to be very difficult for Warren Gatland to start to instill on a group of players who, unfortunately, have kind of been the whipping boys this year. And I want to speak about Warren Gatland a bit more in a bit. But I think that, you know, the experienced players like Liam Williams, who I thought was very good yesterday, Aaron Wainwright was very good yesterday, they're going to be more important than ever in this new generation of Welsh rugby sort of players and talent in trying to turn a corner. Now, they've got a big opportunity in this international window, because they are going to Australia, also a team in a very similar position. Rebuilding, new coach, young players, and lots of work to do. So there's an opportunity for them to try and get some wins, to try and start understanding what it takes to win test matches and to feel comfortable at test level. I genuinely think there are some potential stars in the making. I think Cameron Winnett is a fantastic player. I think that Sam Costello is a very nice flower half. I think Mason Grady is one of the most exciting Welsh players I've seen in a long time. The question is, can they get things all sort of started and start winning matches? The next winner is going to be a Welsh player in Dewey Lake. Fantastic game yesterday. Absolutely brilliant. You know, he's known as a sort of a juggernaut, in inverted commas, somebody that loves to take contact, run into contact, and take players on. And there's a really cool photo of him last time he played on the Springboks, him and Malcolm Marks sort of eyeing each other out. And we sort of spoke about the fact there was going to be a bit of a grudge match. He was the best hooker on the field yesterday by quite a lot of strong margin. Now, yes, Malcolm Marks is coming back from injury and wasn't at his best, and he'll get there. But I think yesterday, Dewey Lake really announced himself as to what he can be as an international player. And as a captain, to go and win that game, well, not going to win the game, but to go put that kind of performance in, speaks volumes of the type of player he is. I mean, I don't even think he's played 10 tests. Definitely less than 15, for example. Captaining his side, putting a performance like that, those kind of performances is what gives a bit of hope to Welsh rugby. So a very impressive performance from him. Another loser. We're going to go and we're going to look at this lad, guy. And he goes by the name of Hercules Smith. And yesterday there were some very cool moments, but the South African National Anthem was not one of them. Very frustrating when we do see our National Anthem absolutely butchered. We all remember, you know, the ghosts of Russ Dumisani from back in the 2007 World Cup when he completely butchered the anthem. And unfortunately, yesterday, Hercules Smith did not do the anthem a lot of justice, unfortunately. Not ideal. Not ideal. And not what you want when you know you get a big occasion like this. And, you know, you've got players playing their first game and then you've got some guy wearing, I don't even want to know what the kind of jacket he was wearing, but I think he spent more time trying to put together the outfit and a bit of a scraggly beard than he did learning the national anthem. And for all that, he had a nice pair of glasses. That was about the way it ended for his performance. So moving right along, we won't bear too much time on him, but please, in the future, people, make sure that whoever you're going to sing the national anthem can sing the national anthem. We are a reasonably talented nation. We're happy to bring our singers along with us. Get the Ecclesia up there in a suit. I reckon he could have done a better job. But anyway, that is the next loser. Let's go to the next winner. And it's another South African player. It is Edvor van der Merwe. The factory of scrum-capped wingers continues to produce. And a player who I've been calling on for a number of years stood up yesterday. And we saw what we've seen in Kurtley Arendse, what we've seen in Chazen Colby, what we've seen many times in that a South African hard-working winger who might not look like the most, although to be fair, I think he is bigger. I mean, he's a lot bigger than a Kurtley Arendse, for example, and a Chazen Colby. But somebody who looks, maybe doesn't look incredibly dangerous, but my goodness, what a performance yesterday. And ironically, I think he was on the man of the match card before he even sort of scored that try. He had some very nice, he had a very nice run down the right-hand side. But for me, it was his defense, which is what I've been saying for years, which is why I think he could be such a good asset for the Springboks. He is incredibly hardworking. The strength that this guy has. If you haven't, go and watch one of the tackles made in the URC where he basically dragged a player. He was diving over. In fact, the player was over the line. All he had to do was fall another 20 centimeters, put the ball down, and he dragged him back up and into touchline. That double tackle yesterday he made was absolutely textbook. And then the try scoring that came with, you know, I think we're looking at a complete player here. We look at Kurtley Arendse and how, you know, he's the rise has been meteoric. Ironically, he was a little bit poor yesterday, actually, in the Bulls game. And Edward van der Merwe, with that kind of performance yesterday, is basically saying to a Chazen Colby, a Kurtley Arendse, a Maxwell Mpimpi, have a bad game at your own peril. I dare you to have a bad game because you give me another shot in the Springbok jersey, you're not taking it away from me. And that's what we want to see. Players who come up and just take the opportunity with both hands and don't look back. Unfortunately, a player who didn't really do that is Jordan Hendrickse, who I will defend and I will continue to defend and I will continue to say he will be a test quality fly half. I have no doubt about that. Absolutely zero doubt. I'm willing to put my, I'll put my reputation out there. I've watched this kid since he's come through at 19 years old. I've watched him for like 3 or 4 seasons now, and he will be a test quality fly half. I have zero doubt about that. There's a reason the Springboks back him and see the talent in him. Yesterday, the occasion got to him, and he looked like a player trying to do too much on the attack, was trying too many things, was trying to pull off the impossible, and I think what he did badly is what Sacha Femigonzulu did well. When Sacha came on, he kept it simple. He really kept it simple. He didn't do anything fancy, for example. He didn't try anything. He just did what he went out to go and try and do. Every single time Jordan Hendrickse got the ball, you felt like he was trying to force the issue. What I will say, 6 from 6 tackles, didn't move an inch back. He had a 115 kg, 1.96 Mason Grady running at him inside center. Grady did not make a meter. And that is a big thing when it comes to a Springbok fly half. You look at Andre Pollard and how good of a defender he is. Jordan Hendrickse is of that mold. He did miss a penalty in the early stages, which I think if he had gotten that, would have settled him down. And it's amazing how things can sort of just compound. Issues can compound each other. I think he nails that first free kick. I think he settles into the game. I think he gets more comfortable. He misses the penalty. He now suddenly feels, shit, I'm under a bit of pressure. I need to like show something. And, you know, he throws that 50-50 pass, which gets intercepted. There was a penalty advantage. I don't know if we're going to talk about that. So it was a bit weird a situation, but and also had a bit of a knock on and sort of threw that bit of Hail Mary pass. But defensively looked very good. And when he came on for the second half, for about 70, 80 minutes, he looked so much more comfortable. It looked like they had told him, just listen, you're playing Test rugby, you're already a Springbok, calm down, go to the basics. And he looked much more comfortable. I think there's so much reason to be excited about both Sacha van Gamsuli and Jordan Hendricks. They're basically the same age, a year apart, and they're going to be playing Springbok rugby for the next 12 years. You know, that they could generally do that. In terms of the final winner, Warren Gatland, which sounds strange considering that they lost 41 points to 13. But what did we say in the week? Warren Gatland threw a team to the wolves and said, right, show me something. Show me that you can play international rugby. They were a point down at halftime against the world champions, a pack that had fewer caps than even Etzebeth, was fronting up and actually sometimes driving the Springboks backwards. They were staying in the game. And the kick game was really on point. They were, I mean, Apele Fassi was good under the air, but they were really putting a lot of pressure on the Springboks. Springboks, for the first 10 minutes they had, were really good, and then were on the back foot for a lot of the half. So Warren Gatlin will look at that performance, and he's Warren Gatlin, he's a perfectionist. He'll sit there and say it wasn't good enough, and we can't lose, and we can't afford to lose like that. He would have watched that game and seen a lot of positives. I think he would have seen certain players putting their hands up, and he will know moving forward who he can trust, who's worth investing, and also maybe who's worth not investing in, you know. And I think that's a bit positive for him. You know, he wants to try and rebuild this Welsh side. It's going to take time. You know, it's the start of a new World Cup cycle. I think that this Welsh side is going to take at least about 18 months. I think about, the, you know, this time next year, maybe, even end of year next year, we'll start to see a Welsh side, which I think will be back to compete. But he's got to get information on these players. He's got to give them the exposure. And yesterday was the perfect kind of game to do that. I mean, how many uncapped players, you know? I thought Edis Bevan, for example, scrum off, had a pretty decent game. You know, there were a couple of players yesterday who looked the part. Tane Plumtree looked the part. Dewey Lake, he gave a responsibility to a young captain, looked the part. So I still think it's positives for him to look at. And I think that he won't say it. He'll never admit it. He's too proud and he's too much of a perfectionist. But I think he'll be secretly quite pleased with what he saw in a lot of that game. Obviously, the capitulation towards the end. But things were looking shaky for the box up to about the 50-minute mark, 50, 60-minute mark. And credit to Wales, because they should never have been in the game, if you look on paper, and yet they were. The final losers of the video is the match officials. And I hate talking about referees. Anybody that watched this channel knows I hate talking about match referees. Yesterday was a tough game to watch. It was stop-start. It was very interrupted. TMO checks, I think very inconsistent, for example. We had three cards in the first half. And I don't think three cards suddenly means the referee's having a bad game. At the end of the day, there can be incidents that warrant cards that happen. And you can't hate on the referee for that happening. You know, if somebody goes and flies for tackle and head-on-head collision, you can't hate on the referee for making it happen. Rio Dyer, for example, cynical player, offside, you know, stops a try being scored. That is cynical. Aaron Wainwright collapsing a maul. Maybe they could have got another couple of warnings, but collapsing a maul on the try line, penalty try, it has to, by definition of the law, be a yellow card. I think Apele Fassi was very lucky, to be perfectly honest. Everyone's talking about, oh, he was off balance. You know, how else is he going to do it? You cannot take a ball with your foot, then rising almost after you come down to head level. You know, it's dangerous. And we've seen, people have been putting in the comments, multiple examples. Barrett was red carded for this. We've seen this incident happen many times and players being sent off, red card for it. And I looked at it at the time and I thought, ooh, I think we're in trouble here. And I think it's a bit of, you know, it wasn't a one-time thing. I think Apele Fassi actually needs to look at his technique in this and he needs to keep that leg down. Yes, it might be natural for him, but you've got to train yourself out of it because it's going to get you in trouble. You know, it's much, and this whole thing of rugby's gone soft is a load of nonsense. We're dealing with a head injuries crisis, and things like this is being done to make the game safer. I mean, he got lucky because I think it was Tane Plumtree, it hit his shoulder. But if that's into his face, for example, the same thing happens, for example, to a Springbok and it's in his face, what do we say? We're all going to be banged for blood. So I think that he got a bit lucky there. I think that Bongi Mnambi got a bit lucky, but I also think that the head clash, I forget it was by the Welsh player, was also a bit lucky. So I think they probably could have been about five cards here yesterday. And so my point is, my issue is not with the cards. It's not with the fact that there were three cards in the first half. I think it should have been two cards in the second half. But for me, far too stop-start. I thought the communication wasn't great. I thought that you know, the TMO, is, which is supposed to be getting more involved, is taking a bit too long still to do that. I thought some of the scrum interpretations were a bit dodgy, and I think that World Rugby wants to promote this game, which is really fast and high octane, and, you know, fewer stoppages. Yesterday was not an example of that. You know, it was a really difficult game to get into because of the stops and starts. And that's not necessarily a criticism of this particular bunch of match officials, but we've got to be careful with how we adjust the laws to ensure that their life is as easy as possible and games are as manageable as possible. So those are the winners and the losers. What are yours? What have I left out? Who have I forgotten? Let me know down in the comments below. Smash a like on the video. Subscribe to the channel as well. Thank you very much for watching. My name is Steve. I'll chat to you soon.